Good evening. I'd like to call the May meeting of the Village of Oak Brook Zoning Board of Appeals to order. Gail, would you call the roll, please?
Yes. Buelen?
Here.
Creach?
Here.
Nimri?
Here.
Rush?
Here.
Davis?
Here. Did everybody get called?
Yes.
We have a quorum. We will proceed with the items on the agenda. There are three items on the agenda, and the order in which they'll be called. The first item is a petition by Bloom for a variation to a front yard setback. The second item is a petition by the Clubhouse in Oak Brook Center for a special use and a modification of an amendment to a special use and a modification to a special use. And then the third item is the Labriola Cafe at 3021 Butterfield Road in the Oak Brook Promenade for an outdoor dining special use. Our last meeting was in January for lack of agenda. I'm sorry, what? Oh, I thought somebody was, sorry, I thought I missed something. Our last meeting was in January, and are there any changes or corrections to the minutes of our January 6th meeting? If not, could we have a motion to waive the reading of the minutes and to approve them as written?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the minutes of the January 6th, 2009 meeting will stand as written. Right, are the Blooms here? Okay, good. Will the two of you be presenting in the nature of factual evidence in support of your petition? If so, I'd like to have you stand and raise your right hands, and then I'll swear you in as witnesses. Do you both swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
Yes.
Okay. And if you would use the microphone or stand at the podium during your presentation and give us your name, we would appreciate it.
Well, I'm Charlie Blum.
Kathy Blum.
Good evening to you both. And we have a packet, and the relief that you're at 3000 Coolidge Street, as we understand it, your property is currently zoned R3, and the typical the statutory setback for R3 zoning is a 40-foot front yard setback. And as we understand it, your setback is 100 feet because the two lots, your lot and another lot, were under one ownership at one time. And when the property was subdivided, that 100-foot setback was put in. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. And what you're seeking is to convert this for a variation to make the setback a 40-foot setback consistent with the other homes in the R3 zone.
That's correct.
All right. You may proceed.
Good evening, Board. 17 years ago, my wife and I purchased parcel land at 3000 Coolidge from Sandy and Jonathan Keene. At the time, they lived next door at 3006 Coolidge. Their residence had a screened porch at the minimum side yard setback facing our lot to the north. They explained to us that at the time, the 100-foot front yard setback was specified on our plat because they used the porch frequently and did not want anyone to build very close to this area where it might impact their enjoyment. They also had some 40-foot spruce trees adjacent to their porch, which they wanted to protect. The Keens sold their property to a developer 9 years ago. The developer subsequently demolished their house and cleared the lot. 4 years ago, our new neighbor built a house with R3 40-foot front yard setback with a side entry drive and garage, now occupying the space where the Keen's spruce trees and screened porch once stood. Over the past 4 years, my wife and I have explored various construction options to further enjoy our Oak Brook residence. We now feel that the unusual circumstances of the Keen's 1992 extraordinary front yard setback are no longer pertinent, and that the extraordinary 100-foot setback stipulated presents a significant hardship to any feasible addition to our residence and our continued enjoyment in this village. All the houses on Coolidge Street except ours are built approximately 40 foot from the street. We have also discussed our situation with our neighbors. They are in agreement with our position and have signed letters, which are now in Ms. Polonic's possession, to attest to this matter. We therefore are simply seeking a 40-foot front yard setback consistent with R3 zoning.
Okay, one of our requirements, and it appears that you have addressed it, is there are standards, zoning standards, that have to be satisfied for the grant of a variation. I show those standards are set forth at pages C and C1 in our packets, and if you wouldn't mind just briefly addressing those. And let me ask one question before you get started. On the adjacent property where the house was with the screened-in porch and the spruce trees, what was the setback for that parcel?
Their house was further forward.
So they were within the 100, I mean, there, it was less than 100 feet on their property?
That's correct.
Okay.
And there
was it 40 feet on theirs, Joe?
I'm sure.
Okay.
I believe that maybe page K, the permit plat, may show the neighboring house.
Yeah, there was a plat. I believe you're right. There was a plat. So their setback was 40 feet, and then when the two lots were subdivided, they imposed the 100-foot setback on yours.
That's correct. Right. So as far as the variation standards, you want me to read the response or?
Yeah, just address each standard, and there are three, as I recall. Well, there are a few more. There's some subdivisions, but just go through them very briefly. We have read this.
Okay. Just to reiterate the response that's noted, is that what you?
Sure.
Okay. The unusual 100-foot front yard setback on only this parcel and this subdivision would probably restrict the value of the property if at any time in the future we wish to sell this property. The extraordinary setback impedes the value of the property. When the property was purchased in 1992, the plat contained a 100-foot front yard setback, not the 40-foot required under R3 zoning, because the original seller used their nearby porch frequently, did not want anyone to build close to this area where it might affect their ambience and spruce trees' root structure. The porch and trees were removed when the developer bought the neighbor's land in the year 2000. The new neighbor, our current neighbor, built a garage and side entry drive in this area. The variation, if granted, would more likely improve the character and zoning consistency of this locality, since our residence is oddly the only one on the street with a front yard setback greater than 40 feet. We have a natural ravine woodland prairie in our backyard. Our usable backyard lawn is small. We have a masonry deck attached to the back of our home. Our master bedroom and bath encompass the entire back of the second floor of the house. These are significant reasons, in addition to the layout of the existing home, why it is not feasible to construct an addition to the back of our house. Actually, this petition for variation is to allow the front yard setback of our property to be treated consistently with properties in the same zoning classification. Ours is the only property in the area with the extraordinary 100-foot front yard setback restriction. We do not believe that granting of the variation will be detrimental to public welfare or injurious to other property or improvements in the neighborhood whatsoever. We do not believe the proposed variation will impair an adequate supply of light whatsoever. Our closest neighbor to our south and our only other neighbor to our west. Additionally, there should not be any increase in the danger of fire or other endangerment with the proposed variation. We believe the proposed variation, being consistent with all the other front yard setbacks on our street, could only increase the property value within the neighborhood. The purpose of the variation requested is to provide for a greater utility of our residents by feasibly allowing for construction options of an additional bedroom / office and further enhance our neighborhood experience. Having built our comfortable, modest home in 1992, we now have a larger family and would like to enlarge our space more in line with the average Oak Brook home today. The hardship was created by the original seller who imposed the 100-foot setback to protect his personal interest at that time. In 2000, the original house and circumstances were no longer existent. The original seller has no current interest in our property whatsoever.
Any questions or comments, Joe?
I have. I've gone through this whole thing, and I'm hard pressed to figure out why the board ever approved this to begin with. It was really a issue that could easily have been handled with covenants.
I agree.
And should have been. And this is.
You're talking about when they went back to
these. When they went from the 40 feet to the 100 feet. This is a variation. If we give a variation, the 100-foot setback will still exist. And I think that's the error. The idea of zoning was to treat all the property in the district is the same as much as possible. This created an oddball lot. And in my mind, I think the action we should take, if we all agree, is to rescind what they did previously and go back to the original setback.
Well,
we will defer to Mr. Colleen as to the feasibility of that.
And I was not here when this happened. However, when Mr. Blum came to us, we talked about there were really two avenues from which to proceed. If he was going to proceed on his own, really the only way to do this would be to seek a variation as he's seeking. The other way would have been to actually amend that previous subdivision plat. Under that scenario, that would have taken both property owners to do that. That would take the property owner to his south, as well as Mr. Blum to be party.
Because both
to that.
Of them were a party
it's,
to
it's,
the.
It's yeah. a single plat. They would have had to amend that plat and actually rescind that setback line. Mr. Blum chose, again, you know, it is a hardship. He didn't place that line on the map. You know, we could, it, under this scenario, we could, one of your recommendations could be that maybe at some later date they could rescind that. That line, but that would be done through a plat of resubdivision.
One of my concerns is, if we give the variation, this is to build a building. Mm-hmm. There are a whole host of things that can go in the lot and be subject to this 100 feet. The building could come into it with the variation, but there are other things in this ordinance that would have to stay still back 100 feet. I think it puts too
like
much
what?
Restriction. Well, I don't remember exactly, but things like swings and. Well,
but if we grant the variation, aren't we now saying in the future, the setback is 40 feet, and whatever can properly be built within that particular setback is proper? I mean, I don't see why
I
that would change
either.
The rest of the. Right. Zoning ordinance.
Well, if it moves the line up to that 40,
yeah. In essence, it does move.
Or everything.
Right, right. It
then
does.
I have no problem.
Okay, all right. And now you don't have you're not coming before you don't have specific plans in mind right now. You're seeking the variation to be consistent.
Right. We're working with the architect as we speak, but we're not going to go any further until we can resolve this issue.
All right.
With the architect.
And the variation, if we were to grant it, would run
With the land.
Run with the land.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I will say, I talked with Village Engineer Durfee, who's been here for over 30 years, and he cannot recall another situation like this. We have,
Makes
we probably
no sense.
Have 3,500 lots in
yeah.
town,
yeah.
and this
Good
is
point.
This is the anomaly.
Yeah.
And
it's an anomaly because of the specific desire of the person that owned the two lots to have a view. And to keep the spruce trees.
And it would be one thing if the property owner to the south was the original owner and their house was the original house, then we probably would have some additional discussion here. But that person who imposed those regulations, those restrictions, is gone.
Yeah.
And the house is
gone. And
different.
The house is gone.
Right. Right. So it's.
That lot had been sold twice since the original owner, so it's.
Okay. All right. Any other, Glenn?
Yes. Mr. Blum. Indicated that there were letters from the neighbors.
I just received them in support.
In support of this. How about the neighbor at 3006?
I spoke to the neighbor at 3006. He called the village, and he was in support, he told me.
And he is,
and
or
his
wife did
here.
Sign one of the letters.
Okay.
And the other was our next closest neighbor.
Across the street.
Actually, the only other neighbor that can see this area in discussion. We only have two neighbors. This other one is kind of kitty corner on the
And Mr. Chairman, the neighbor to the north did not object to this. That was the Village of Oak Brook.
Oh, all right. Well, you're the neighbors on two sides, aren't they?
Yes.
All right. How about the other side then?
I'm not sure about that person.
Okay.
We're in this little orange rectangle.
Right.
I mean, it didn't ruin the view to the south.
All right, any other comments? Any comments from any members of the public who are here to make comments? Apparently not. Okay. All right, well, thank you. If there are no other questions, is there a motion to, in support of the Blum petition, to grant the variation to the setback requirement to change it from 100 feet to 40 feet? The standards having been satisfied and set forth in writing in our packet at pages C and C1.
Now, so moved.
All right, second? All right, it's been moved and seconded that we recommend the grant of your petition. Gail, would you call the roll, please?
Buelen?
Yes.
Creech?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes. Our board will recommend the relief that you're seeking, and your next step will be to go to the Village Board, and Gail can tell you what that procedure is about.
This matter will now go to the Village Board of Trustees on May 26th in this boardroom.
Thank you for your attention in this matter.
Yes, thank you for your presentation. Is there a representative for the clubhouse? Good evening. The clubhouse is located in the Oak Brook Center. Is your address 298? Is that the way I didn't realize there were addresses in
there? Yeah, all the locations.
Do we see these? I've never noticed them before.
Try and find them.
Yeah.
In any event, 298 Oak Brook Center, and the petition is to amend an existing special use, which was it granted in 1998?
That's correct.
To amend a special use relating to outdoor dining, and the amendment would modify the current dining area roughly on the west side of the clubhouse, and then you want to expand the special use to permit you to construct a new outdoor dining area on the south side, and both dining areas would have a 40 seat capacity.
That's correct.
Okay, and you may proceed. And I might mention that the plan commission, the recommendation was to grant approval of your request, and the vote was 6-0.
Yes.
All right. With various conditions that were imposed, which we can address later.
Right.
Would you raise your right hand? Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
I do.
State your name and please.
My name is Mark O'Sullivan, and I'm the general manager at the Clubhouse Restaurant. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity. The Clubhouse would like to amend the special use permit that was granted in 1998. And due to the following happenstance, in the summer of 2008, the Barnes & Noble asked for and received permission to use the clubhouse property for construction of their new facility in the Oak Brook Shopping Center. This caused significant changes in the facade, planter, and railings on the existing west side patio. We believe that by amending the current special use permit, that this is an opportunity to improve both the appearance and safety of the current patio, as well as we believe that all the proposed work will not only protect the public safety and welfare, but it will increase it. I can review the standards at this point, if that is okay.
Well, now what you were just referring to was the modification of the current dining area.
That's correct.
Is that primarily to be consistent with what Barnes & Noble did with respect to their area?
Yeah, and you can reference pages K, J, N, and O, and I believe those kind of give you an idea of what is there now and picture of the new railing that was installed. That door that railing is in front of is actually a door to the clubhouse, and that area was given to Barnes & Noble so they could complete their, I guess, grand design of what it would look like. So the clubhouse actually gave part of its ownership to that facade to the Barnes & Noble.
But you're not decreasing the size of that outdoor dining area. You're modifying. It's an aesthetic move, isn't it, primarily?
Primarily, yes.
Okay.
As well as, I believe, a safety move as well.
Okay, and what's the safety move?
Currently, there's temporary wrought iron barriers, and we would like to move to permanent steel barriers.
All right. Okay, now, why don't we, this is all part of a single amendment, so why don't we go ahead and address the construction of the new area?
Yeah, I can go through them, all the changes point by point, if you'd
like. Yeah, sure.
So the first request is to change the barrier system material and design, and the reasoning behind that is to upgrade the visual appearance and flow uniformly with the new barrier / fencing installed at Barnes & Noble. And again, you can see that by referencing pages K, J, N, and O. The second part of that request is to make it a permanent barrier system. And primarily for safety concerns, we believe that a permanent steel barrier will provide more safety and stability than a temporary one. Taking the barriers in and out each year, I think, lessens their structural integrity. They are currently in good shape, but I think over the years, continuing to remove and install them is asking for trouble. And when we do the new fencing, we're going to re-core all the holes in the cement so that we won't have an issue with that. since we're taking the opportunity to make this request, we'd also like to expand the seating to the similar area. You're calling it the south side. I'm referring it as the east side in my notes here. We believe that the outdoor seating expansion will allow the clubhouse Oakbrook to better compete with neighboring restaurants with substantial outdoor seating that have been constructed since the original special use was enacted in 1998. This most notably in the Lombard community. I think anyone that drives down Butterfield Road can see probably 20 to 30 new restaurants constructed since 1998. The clubhouse will better be able to accommodate and serve its clientele and the public interest, which previously had to be turned away due to inadequate seating availability. Also, the increase in revenue that this would provide would become especially important in these difficult economic times. I think the patio generated revenues almost $250,000 in 2008. So, and then there's some other small changes that we're requesting, and I want to point these out as well. Outdoor portable heaters may be used is also an addition to that request. Currently, we have no plans to utilize them, but would like the ability to do so should the need arise. They are already in place at other locations within the Oakbrook Center, notably Cheesecake and Real Club. If utilized, they would be set to a standard to ensure the health, safety, and welfare of the public, as the rest of the patio equipment does and has always done.
Excuse my interruption. The outdoor heaters, are they permanently installed or?
That we're asking for temporary portable heaters.
They're heaters that you can move around.
Correct.
All right. Do those require that should be part of a special use?
I think since it's amenity that's part of this request, I think it should be included.
All right. Okay.
And that was our thought process too. We weren't sure, but we figured we might as well put it in. And then the emergency egress gates will be labeled exit only. This is just to conform to village code. And there was a line in there that said service stations, or there was a line in there that said a waiter station, similar in design to the barrier planter boxes will be installed. We've changed that language to service stations may be installed. We would like to keep all of the service stations indoors due to sanitary concerns. And I spoke with Ramesh Patel from the DuPage County Health Department, and he agrees with us as well that that's probably a more sanitary way to go. And the last one is that the patio lights turned off when the patio is not in use. Previously in 1998, all the lights were on the same circuit, and the mall was gracious enough to supply an electrician and break off the patio lights so they're on separate circuits, so there's no longer a need to cover them up. They can simply be turned off when they're not in, or when the patio is in use. And just to note that Mr. Chuck Fleming, the senior general manager for the Oak Brook Center, has approved this request.
Yeah, that letter of approval is at B in our packets. Now, there were a handful of conditions that were, the matter went before the Plan Commission and was approved. Your request was approved subject to a handful of conditions, and those are set forth at pages 7A and 7B of our packets. And I take it there hasn't been any change in those conditions, and those conditions are acceptable and to be a part of your special use request?
That's correct.
Okay. Well, and on the new seating area, or the new outdoor area, that'll be consistent aesthetically with the other outdoor area?
Yeah, there. When it was built, there's two symmetrical areas that could have a patio. So.
All right. All right, if you would address the standards, they're page D of our packets.
We're subject to three standards. The first is this type described in subsection A1 of this section is deemed necessary for the public convenience at this location, and that is not applicable in this case. Special standard number two is so designed, located, and proposed to be operated that the public health, safety, and welfare will be protected. The outdoor dining area will be operated in accordance with the rules of operation submitted. Those will protect the public health, safety, and welfare. The clubhouse has been operating an outdoor seating area since 1998. Without incident or harm to either the public or its patrons. And the third standard is would not cause substantial injury to the value of the property and the neighborhood in which it is located. The granting of an additional outdoor dining area will have no negative effect to other properties. The second outdoor seating area will improve the visual appeal of the property by adding a symmetrical look to coincide with the approved outdoor or the existing outdoor seating area. An adequate walkway will be provided so that pedestrian traffic is not affected or impeded, and in such a way that snow removal will not be hindered.
Okay. Any questions, comments from the board? Anybody here in the public wish to raise any questions or issues? The conditions, is anybody see a need to cover the conditions specifically? They are set forth. It's conditions 1 through 6, pages 7A and 7B. Does anybody see any other conditions that we might want to think about? Yes. Baker?
Yeah, I would like to get it, before this goes to the village board, have the fire department take a look at the space heaters and get an opinion. We don't need it back here, just
right.
To have them take
a look.
What
we'll do is as part of the building permit that they would need to install this, we'll ask for the fire department to review that.
So you don't need it for this? No. Is that what you're saying?
I don't recall the space heaters coming up before. Do we have those in any other?
Well,
I know what they are and I've seen them, but I just don't recall us getting into it.
We have them, Mr. Sullivan, he said they're at the Cheesecake.
Permanently installed at Cheesecake, yes.
And at the Real Club. Again, they're just an amenity. And if I could add, Mr. Chairman, there was one feature to this old special use as well as many of the others that are in place. There's always been this time constraint about special uses. They have that provision where they start up in April, begin to be set up in April, and they have to be down sometime in October.
October 15 is our.
We have been having a lot of problems with that. With our weather seeming to our summer months seems to move more into the fall.
What summer?
We haven't gotten it yet, but as example, last year we had a number of occasions where out at the Oak Brook Promenade, the Grotto Restaurant, the Kona, the McCormick and Schmick, they could not have their seating areas open. It was the end of October or first week of November. It was 75 degrees out. The Redstone Restaurant, which is in Oak Brook Terrace, there they had all this business. So I think over time we may have some of these developments actually come back and seek an amendment to modify that time constraint, especially for those that are self-enclosed. For those that have to be removed to maintain snow removal and things, that's one thing. But with some of these, like this, where there's going to be a permanent feature, or with a grotto, or the McCormick and Schmidt, where they actually have a designated patio area that's only accessed from inside the restaurant, that time frame is almost an impediment.
Well, is there some easier way to address that than having each special use grantee have to come back and?
If you can think of a way, I'd appreciate knowing about that.
Is snow removal?
It's not in the code.
It's not in the code, but it's something that is contained in many of the ordinances. So the ordinance that was adopted, let's say for J. Alexander's, right, has this time frame.
Well, I remember that. I mean, right, we always put an October. Right. October
because that
15.
Was something that originally the mall, correct, it started, and it kind of passed on from ordinance to ordinance, and nobody has really objected it until recently.
So. So you're saying you can amend something to the zoning, the general,
right,
zoning code, and say this is.
Right. I mean, maybe we, you know.
Instead of going by each property.
That's the problem. I mean, what we'll do is we'll consult with our village attorney to find out if there's a better
some
mechanism.
Way to do that. All
because
right.
We've done probably 30 of these.
Well, and with the outdoor heaters too, that might just sort of naturally extend it through.
So was your comment made to extend this, the time period for this one? So
no, I just said that, okay, we've in essence removed the time frame.
Right.
So if you look at the old ordinance, there's this October to,
right,
April to October. In this amendment, we've removed that.
Okay.
And Chuck Fleming has no objection to that at all.
Right.
Was the reason for removal because of snow removal?
In this case, I don't think the issue of snow removal is going to be an issue.
Yeah, I don't think it really is anywhere.
Well,
if they
can't plow snow,
or they don't knock down the fences, they shouldn't be plowing.
Well, that's the key. If they cannot knock down the fence, like some of the older restaurants in Oak Brook Center, they have just an area right in front where maybe they have a single area of chairs and tables. There, it gets a little bit tight for snow, and that was really the rationale behind that original time frame. So
it seems to me that becomes a problem of the owner to remove the snow.
It is,
and,
but it's really an impediment to the tenant, because there are other similar establishments located in adjacent areas that are not subject to those
yeah,
rules.
That's what I mean. I don't think we should have them.
Okay, the standards having been addressed. The conditions having been referred to and spelled out on pages 7A and 7B and acceptable to the petitioner, is there a motion to approve the request?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Gail, will you call the roll, please?
Buelen?
Yes.
Creech?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes. So we will recommend to the board your petition, and Gail can tell you what the next step in the procedure would be.
Okay, this will now go to the Village Board of Village Board period on May 26, Tuesday, 7:30 p.m. in the boardroom.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Our final request is petition by the Labriola Cafe at 3021 Butterfield Road and the Promenade for a special use for outdoor dining. And I don't know, I'm personally getting hungry with all these requests. Good evening. And as I understand it, you currently do not have outdoor dining and you're seeking a special use for outdoor dining. Your petition was presented to the Plan Commission, and subject to the conditions that they imposed, six conditions, I believe, at pages 8 and 9 of our packet, that decision was 6-0 supporting your petition. And you seek an outdoor dining area of approximately 28 seats. Okay. Would you raise your right hand? Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give this hearing will be the truth?
Yes, I do.
You state your name and you may proceed.
Nicholas Andrews, General Manager for Labriola Bakery Cafe. We are here to request the special use for the purpose of constructing a outdoor patio seating adjacent to the front of our cafe for the purpose of increasing our seating to 28 people. outside. We feel as though the cafe has met with some great success to this point since our opening in November, and we thank you for partnering with us to make that successful opening. But in the spirit of the French bistro style of cafe that we have and how it lends itself very well to the outdoor seating, we feel as though we would be a good fit in the Oakbrook Promenade, as there are currently three others that have the outdoor seating as well.
And you're at the south part of the promenade?
That's correct.
And the seating will be directly in front of your restaurant?
Yes, sir.
All right.
The seating would be enclosed in a metal fencing that would be all done by a professional contractor, and that metal fencing would then also be protected from the parking area by movable objects that were decorated as planters for the aesthetics.
When you say removable, you mean your seating will, those barriers will be only during the dining period, during the dining season?
Actually,
or will they be permanent?
Permanent, immovable.
I thought you said removable. Pardon me.
No, that's my fault. No, immovable. They would be 650 pounds apiece with the concrete insets inside of them that prevent any mishaps from the parking lot.
And the conditions are set forth at pages 8 and 9 of our packets, and I take it you're familiar with the conditions. These were, they're also set forth in the plan commission letter, which is at 7A and 7B, but I think also at 8 and 9 of our packets, those conditions are acceptable to you?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, 8 and 8A of our packet. Down at the bottom where it says recommendation of the plan commission.
Yes, sir, those are.
All right, would you just briefly address the standards for the grant of a special use? And those are the standards that we must find have been satisfied.
Those are the special use factors, is that correct?
Yes.
Sir? Yes. Is of the type described in subsection A1 of this section is deemed necessary for the public convenience at that location? Our response to this is yes. This provides the public the opportunity to the outdoor dining. It enhances the experience of that, as well as stimulates some further retailing with our neighbors in the Oakbrook Promenade. It gives them the opportunity to enjoy the landscape and, as I said, stimulate some further shopping. Number two, designed and located, proposed to the operated, that the public health and safety and welfare will be protected, and absolutely without question, the design implementation of the operations would have the public's welfare and well-being as its first priority, no question. And then thirdly, this would not cause any substantial injury to the value of other property in the neighborhood in which is located, and without question, there will be no injury as a result of the outdoor seating being erected.
Right. What stores are adjacent to your restaurant?
Amerik immediately to our east and to the west, and to our east is actually vacant currently. There
okay.
is Murphy's Irish Outfitters a couple doors down,
right.
as well as Pendleton retail.
Okay. All right. All right. Any questions or comments? Yes, Jeff.
Maybe Bob. Is there a requirement that these seating areas have the egress gates as we saw in the last one and in this one? My point is because one half of this has an egress gate and the other half does not.
It doesn't have access to the
one. Let's. If you look on page F.
Right. There's no.
I'd be happy to address that.
The issue we have here is. This is somewhat unique in that part of the outdoor dining area will be accessed through from the restaurant, whereas the other area is more of just it doesn't have that capability.
But why are we required to have the egress gate if it's accessed through the restaurant? I mean, why not have no gate?
Well, I will say what I've always heard is the reason. I don't know the exact reason, but what I've heard as a reason at least once or twice, is that with some of these outdoor dining areas, there was always a concern with their liquor license that someone would come from the outside.
Okay.
And get in instead of coming through the front door.
Okay.
And that's why most of them are set up so that once you're in the outdoor seating area, you, the only way you can go is out.
Is there a liquor license with this property?
They have a they have a liquor license at this establishment.
But I mean, is there concern bringing liquor in? Somebody bringing?
Well, I think it was always with underaged people.
Then how?
But again,
do we...
that's going to be up then to the if this were to be approved as proposed, then it's really going to be up to the manager to police that.
Right.
In both cases.
In all cases, absolutely.
Well, then I guess my point is the one half that doesn't have a door to the inside restaurant has no gate, and the half of the other, the east half of the dining has a gate, which has a door to the inside. Why wouldn't it be simpler to eliminate the gate that they have on the east side, the east half?
Well, what is the purpose of the gate?
To satisfy the requirements as we understood them.
Right, and maybe...
Again, that is always... That
we're
is always
just locked into a requirement.
We're just kind of going, yeah.
Nobody knows why, right.
If you look at the very first outdoor dining ordinance, you'll see time frames, and you'll see this gate that goes one way. I mean...
Well, and Bob, part of it was that access was always through the restaurant to the outdoor dining area. So people would only go to the outdoor dining area through the restaurant and exit the outdoor dining area through the restaurant, with the exception of needing an emergency egress gate to get out in case of an emergency.
Well, is that what it is then? It's intended to be an emergency?
It's a building code issue, but in this case, you have one that
doesn't have
that really, I mean, again, people, the only way you can get in it, we could make them put in a gate, but it would then have to move both ways.
Right.
I mean, that would be the...
What do you mean, move both ways?
Well, okay.
The tables there, too.
Yeah, the tables on the west, the only way to get into that area, you have to come out of the restaurant.
Yeah, I see that. But,
right.
But actually, Bob, the problem is if that gate swings out, you're impeding the egress of the
restaurant. Then
you're
going to impede, correct. And
but
then
if, you have, if you have a gate on the west side of that seating area, then it doesn't interfere with anything.
Yeah, we could put it over here.
Yeah. Won't interfere with anything.
That'd be fine.
There's no interference.
That'd be fine.
But
we can do that.
Why bother?
You're asking why we don't have a gate, not why bother.
My point is, let's eliminate the gate on the other half. Because actually, I think that creates more
of a
problem.
I think there's a fire hazard concern, too, if you don't have those gates.
No, have just an opening in the fence.
If you have an opening, you're providing full access
out.
Full access. So, again, I defer to you. I don't think there's really a code issue here. Relative to this, I'm trying to rationalize maybe why some have had them in the past.
Would you prefer to not have the gate on the east side?
Yes, we would. I would prefer to have it open on both sides if that so pleases the board.
Fine. I don't know. Like you said, we're stuck in a loop.
Well, here. I was looking at the conditions to see what was addressed with respect to the gate and the conditions.
If I may just shed just a
sure.
bit of light from my own experience, Mr. Kalin is correct that the outdoor seating in past has had those gates that would not open but to go out as an emergency exit for the purpose of maintaining a safe environment from a alcohol standard and the underage drinking for those restaurants and clubs that card on the way in. So it prevents anybody from escaping a bouncer or someone that's in security fashion in the front door and allows that. So that's a large part of why that is, to my history, to my knowledge. For our purposes, you know, we do have a liquor license, but we just sell a few beers and wines to complement some of our menu items, and we certainly don't cater to the young, and we're a quick casual. So, you know, as you approach, and that is where that policing happens up front and immediate. So the need for a gate of any kind for us is really unnecessary, and as part of this plan, strictly to facilitate an acceptance of the approval, an approval of the proposal.
I don't know. We're just,
well,
we're
I mean,
just
in the
allowing it because we've made everybody else do it. It doesn't seem.
I guess if
Mr. Chairman, can we ask? In
sure.
this case, if people sit out in this area, are they, could they be waited on, or do they always have to go inside to order their food?
They all have to go inside to order their food.
Right.
That's
See,
correct.
That's one of the differences, too. It's almost like the outdoor seating area with McDonald's. I mean, everybody orders in. They can go sit outside.
Right.
The clubhouse actually will take orders out at the table and bring you know, menu items and drinks out to them. So there is a differentiation between how some of these operate.
And that has some bearing on the gate?
I don't see what it is.
It's just some, no, but I mean, again, sorry, with some of these, they want to maintain a very controlled environment, like the clubhouse. The only way you can get into that outdoor dining area is you must enter and go out through the...
But it would be more controlled if the gate wasn't even there.
Right.
It was just a fence.
Normally, when we...
Well, you have to have an opening.
You have to have an opening.
Normally, when we put our motions in and our conditions, it's subject to permitting, and permitting is always done within the code of the Village of Oak Brook.
And I will tell you, there is no code requirement that I'm aware of that makes them put a gate here.
And if that's the case, it should not be within the purview of this board.
I agree. I think
to make conditions.
Yes.
Such as that.
Well, that was my question, is should we do anything to change these conditions? There is a reference in 4B to the gate. We could either omit that or leave it in and leave it up to the petitioner as to whether to put the gate in.
The only code requirement would be, because there is an exterior door from the restaurant that goes through that east dining area, it would be required to have an opening in the fence. You cannot impede the emergency egress. So the gate is installed for the emergency egress, but it could just as easily be an opening in the fence to allow for the emergency egress.
So it seems to me we should leave that option up to the petitioner.
We're basically, other than the idea of alcohol control, that's really the, but that's...
That's theirs, too.
That's theirs, too.
Certainly our burden.
Right.
Well, I guess maybe we should leave the conditions as is, and then you can choose to...
But then they'd be locked in having to approve the gate, or having to install the gate.
What if we said the emergency egress gate, comma, if any?
Okay.
Comma. Does that do it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sounds like it.
Yeah.
All right.
But if that door to the restaurant is an emergency door and you remove the gate, now it's a solid fence, you're blocking it.
It's not a solid fence. It would have to be open.
It's got to be open, so you cannot go with it. Okay.
Correct.
So you're just eliminating the gate.
You're eliminating the gate and leaving.
So we'll put that in the condition in 4B, the emergency egress gate, if any. And that'll put it within your discretion. All right. The standards having been addressed, the conditions. Yes. Oh, any comments, questions? Okay. The standards having been addressed and the conditions subject to the change that we just made set forth on pages 7A and 7B, is there a motion to approve the petition?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Deal, it's been moved and seconded. Would you call the roll, please?
Ulan?
Yes.
Breach?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes. So we will recommend the approval of your petition, and your next step would be at the Village Board, and Gail can mention that to you.
It will be at the Village Board on Tuesday, May 26th at 7:30 in this boardroom.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Who's our new Village Trustee Liaison?
That's a good question.
They haven't had the meeting yet. So.
They haven't had the meeting with the new trustees. Well, I thought that was last night.
They get sworn in.
No, but he's asking who's the liaison.
We don't have a liaison for the...
Not yet.
Right.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just update you as to what is coming.
Sure.
Something that I have not experienced, on June 2nd at our regular meeting, there will be an appeal filed. It's already been filed, but it will be heard by this body. I think the village has done one of these in the past. I think you were the chair. And this
and
involves...
You're going to ask me what I recall about it?
I'm not asking what you recall, but it involves... This involves a fence issue in terms of how we measure the height of that fence.
Not that one over.
No, this is over on Madison Street.
Not again.
That one that we...
That
wrote?
One. That one. So that appeal, and our village attorney will be there. And again, it's really an appeal of my decision. So that's how it will operate. The next item of interest, The following night...
Just remind us about the presentation and what's, who are the parties and so forth?
The parties would be the Village of Oak Brook, which I think the representative will be our village attorney, and the other party will be the applicant and his legal staff.
So the village attorney is trying to, he would argue, to uphold your decision?
Well, at least represent the village's side of how the decision was...
And you were the...
Yes.
Arbitrator or judge or...
Right. And it'll be really up to this body then to make a final determination. And your determination then is final. It does not go to the village board.
That's a first.
Yes.
Just in appeals.
That's why, again, there are very few of these, but this is your opportunity.
And then who represents the homeowner?
The homeowner will have his attorney here.
Right.
And again, it's really the way the code is written, and it's... A determination needs to be made.
Sorry.
So then the next day, then on June 3rd, we have tentatively set up...
A special meeting. Joint meeting.
A joint meeting of the Plan Commission and the Zoning Board of Appeals to hear a presentation, the public hearing, on a proposed plan unit development regulations. And the plan unit development regulations would really be a new tool that would be used to process larger new developments in the commercial corridor. So example, let's say the Clearwater development, if that were to have come to us, brand new one, instead of going through a laborious process of crafting text amendments and special uses and variations and all sorts of other things, it would fall under the parameters of the PUD. And then the PUD would allow for the entire development to be reviewed as a single package. And as part of that, you would be able to control architecture, design, and signage as part of the initial proposal. So it basically, what you see is what you would get.
Now you got a lot of leeway in what you can require, right?
Correct. I mean, it gives the village a lot of leeway, flexibility in terms of it provides for some give and take between the developer and the village, but it's really the type of tool that almost all communities use to process larger developments. And we've done those types of things, but we haven't done them under the guise of a PUD. I mean, if you were to look at what Oak Brook Center has, that's really a large PUD. If you look at the McDonald's campus next door, that in essence is a PUD. So that will be before you, and instead of making the consultant go through two hearings, we're going to bring both bodies together. You can both discuss it. You'll make separate motions, but it should provide for a more streamlined process to get it to the village board.
And
it's a hearing. Is 3 hours going to be enough for that?
It could very well be enough.
No. What was the question?
I'm
sorry.
It started at 7 too.
I mean, you got the planning commission. You got us. We're going to go.
Well, you're
going to
be
this
together. Is
right.
It?
Right.
On you said signage, does that apply for across the village or just for PUDs?
It would be in the PUD. Mm-hmm. We have a second project that's underway, but it's not quite yet for review. Is a comprehensive rewrite of our sign code.
You don't feel there's an overlap between those two? The signage for PUD and the signage for the...
No, there's no overlap.
Two separate issues.
Separate issue.
Okay. In a PUD, you could tell them what colors to make the sign and what color to do the lettering. And
remember when we did the promenade, remember they wanted to come in with these blade signs and things. That's the type of thing that we could get pictures of, and we would know exactly what would be in front of each store and what it would look like. And that's just part of the
advantage is it eliminates, when you go through the various types of zoning relief, the petitioner often has to show a hardship.
And sometimes it's difficult.
Right.
If your codes are vague on an issue or are overly restrictive, I mean, it's pretty hard to show hardship.
Right. So this is the hearing for the approval of that ordinance.
Well, it'll be for the recommendation. So
the recommendation,
right? And then the next step would be the final step would be the village board.
Okay.
So we've been working on this for.
And when are we going to get the reading material?
We will get that out very soon.
So it won't be the weekend before.
No, you will not get it 3 days before. My goal is to get it to you at least 2 weeks before.
Right.
at least.
No, it's just the one that has something to do with this court hearing that we had?
No.
Okay, this is a separate.
This is separate.
No. No. That's a whole nother issue.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of interesting things coming before us.
Good.
So that's all I have.
Right.
Well, there being no further new business and no old business, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. We are adjourned.
Wait.
Oops.
I asked a question about the 3 hours. Do you guys feel that we should have that meeting a little bit earlier than 7:30?
I suggested 7.
7 is what I had on the email.
That's what is
I think
suggestion.
It is earlier.
7 o'clock is what I said.
You're not talking about the hearing.
No, I'm talking starting about the PUD.
The PUD.
I've heard the applicant, or the not the applicant, our consultant make this presentation twice. We had two presentations to our Commercial Revitalization Task Force, and in 2 hours, it pretty much, he was able to lay it out there. People could ask questions. I mean,
okay,
3 hours should be enough. Okay. I really do.
So, what time are we starting?
I would
like
say 7 o'clock.
We'd like to start at 7 if everybody can make it at 7.
Okay.
Because we have to have a quorum of each of the bodies.
You don't have to leave on the 2nd, you stay here for the 3rd.
You'll be all tired out for the 2nd.
So will 7 o'clock work for everyone?
Sure.
Yes. Fine with me.
What's the dress? We don't want to be showing up with a plan. I haven't gone to a planning commission meeting for a while.
If you want to wear a...
We're okay the way we are?
Absolutely.
All right.
Will there be air conditioning by then?
I don't know. We'll
I've got
see
it
if
in my notes.
Can...
We'll take care of it.
We have a fan that we can use.
Okay. Well, it'll be a busy time for us.